Today, for this session on the Real Estate Investment Trust Framework, which was recently gazetted and published and brought into the public domain by the Securities and Exchange Commission. So, as we note, there's a full house today. I hear we had over 250 registered participants. So, obviously, this is a topic which is very timely and of great interest to all the participants, both investors and property developers and the general public alike. So thank you for being with us. The session today is co-hosted by the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce and the Chamber Academy, together with PricewaterhouseCoopers Sri Lanka office. By way of introduction to our panel members, I think we have all the key people here today who have been involved in formulating and bringing to light the REITs framework for Sri Lanka. We have Mr. Viraj Dayarajan, President's Counsel, Chairman of the Securities and Exchange Commission of Sri Lanka, Mr. Dubin Fernando, Chairman of the Colombo Stock Exchange, Dr. Harshana Surya Peruma, Director Corporate Affairs of the Securities and Exchange Commission, Mrs. Nayanti Abe Vikrama, Director Legal and Enforcement of the Securities and Exchange Commission, Mr. Ravi Abe Surya, CEO and Director of Candor Group, and Co-Chair of the National Agenda Committee on Finance and Capital of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce, and Mr. Rajiv Bandaranaike, CEO of the Colombo Stock Exchange. So a warm welcome to all our panel members. Before we start off the session, may I kindly request the audience to keep their mics on mute and to keep their video cameras off so that we have an uninterrupted session. And also, whatever the questions you have, to pose it on the chat box, which will be there on the platform. And thank you also to many participants who sent questions in advance. So we saw tremendous interest. And we got some questions in advance, which we hope to cover today. So to start off the session with, may I invite Mr. Viraj Dayaratna, Chairman SEC, to make his opening remarks.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. And Rubini, first of all, let me take this opportunity to thank the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce and PwC for organizing this webinar. Because I think creating awareness and educating the public as well as would-be investors is very important. So, I'm happy to announce the fact that this is the first time a new product is being brought into the capital market. The last product to be brought in was were corporate bonds, and that was way back in 1997. So when we assumed office, that was in the latter part of January this year, the SEC considered as to what we can do as far as new products are concerned. And as everybody knows, the prices of real estate is very high in Sri Lanka and it keeps appreciating. So anything to do with real estate, we felt was a good investment. And we thought REITs, which has been in operation around the globe for some time, was a good product to introduce. And also REITs, this was nothing new. Discussions have been going on between the CSE, SEC and the other stakeholders for a considerable length of time. And stakeholders had been consulted, the public had been consulted, but unfortunately it was implementation that was lacking. So and also we felt the time was opportune because people are trying to diversify their portfolio, and also at a time when interest rates are low, we felt that this was the ideal time to introduce REITs. And the secretariat started work on it, spearheaded by none other than Dr. Harshana Surya Peruma. And we had the cooperation, fullest cooperation of the CSE. Several rounds of discussions were held, and they put together the framework. Initially, we had to decide whether the present legal regime permitted the introduction of REITs. Well, we looked at the law and we were convinced that it was possible. And what had to be done was to bring in the framework as an extension of the unit trust code, which is presently available. So this is actually an extension of the unit trust code, which enables the setting up of REITs, and the rules had to be drafted by the SEC because SEC will be the regulator as far as REITs are concerned. So we needed to finalize the rules, which we did within a very short space of time. And we introduced the rules by way of a gazette notification, and this was published as an extraordinary gazette notification on the 31st of July this year. So that brings in the legal framework for the setting up of REITs, and these rules will cover the setting up of a REIT as well as how a REIT will operate. So now I think the general public may want to know what is a REIT. So it's also another investment vehicle similar to mutual funds, where an individual, if an individual is unable on his own to get involved in investments in real estate, you get together, and in simple terms, it's where space is rented out. And of course, Harshana will go into the nitty gritties and use the technical terms, but let me be very, in very simple terms, it is where space is rented out, and out of the proceeds, the proceeds of the rent income is distributed amongst the unit holders, which is equivalent to the dividends you receive where you invest in shares. So that in simple terms is a REIT, and it can be it can not only be office space, it can be a shopping mall, it can be a hospital, it can be a hotel, it can be anything, a warehouse. And the one other aspect that I want to emphasize is it can extend to infrastructure. For instance, the best example I can think of is a power project where that can come in as a REIT. The investor can bring it for the benefit of the public, where it can become a REIT, and the proceeds can be utilized by the investor for another power purpose. So I don't want to go into detail during this limited time that I have, but these are options that are available to us. So it's an ideal opportunity to diversify the portfolio one has. And there are certain conditions that we have imposed. We have to be mindful of our market. So we have made certain modifications. There are three primary requirements in the setting up of a REIT. That is, the building that you bring in should be fully completed. You can't have a building which is not fully completed. You can't bring in a building of that nature to a REIT. It has to be fully completed. There has to be 20% occupancy. And also it should be income generation. It should be an income generating project. So those are the three main requirements as far as the setting up of a REIT is concerned. And one other advantage, as far as advantages are concerned for investors, you have the tax pass-through benefit that is presently available to unit trust, that will be available to REITs as well. And the most significant advantage is 90% of the proceeds, the income that the REIT generates, has to be distributed amongst the unit holders. So this is one of the main benefits that investors will have. And we have, in finalizing the rules, we were mindful of the fact that there can be, as we know, not only in Sri Lanka, anywhere, when one deals with property, real estate, there can be a lot of fraud, particularly as far as title is concerned. So in the rules, we have given importance we have considered that as an important area where we should have proper rules, and we have covered that aspect well in our rules. And also the valuation is another aspect that we were concerned about, so we have adequate rules to cover that as well. The other requirement is that we will permit only listed rules. So once the REIT is set up, the rules cover, I don't want to go into details, Harshana and Ayanti will cover those aspects. The rules are very comprehensive. And also I would like to announce the fact that, you know, we had to start somewhere, but the rules are very comprehensive, but maybe we need to fine tune them. So that can happen only as we go on. The rules are now available. If we find that need to be amended, certain changes have to be brought about, we will not hesitate to do that. One has to start somewhere, and then depending on how it works, we have to be flexible and change the rules in order to ensure that the REITs can effectively function. So that's how we have set about in drafting the rules. They are, of course, they are very comprehensive. So there is no need for any investor to be worried. We have taken into consideration the interests of the investors. That doesn't mean that the rules are too harsh. It's prohibitive or it's not attractive to somebody to set up a REIT. So we have balanced all stakeholder interests, and that's how the rules have been drafted. So let me not talk for too long. The CSC has prepared the rules and submitted the rules to us, and we are looking at them, and we will certainly approve them at the next commission meeting, which is scheduled for the first week of September. So then the entire framework will be ready, and I'm happy to say that several parties have shown interest in setting up a REIT. So that is what is important, not only having the framework, but the proponents have to come forward to set up a REIT. So I think we are on track. And let me conclude by saying that there has been some concern about the stamp duty, which might be quite expensive. But as lawyers, we know any property transaction attracts stamp duty. So whether that can be done away with as far as REITs are concerned is a policy decision that the government will have to take. And let me assure that is something that those who wish to set up REITs will have to pursue. But certainly we will support them and try, if not to take away the entirety of the stamp duty, at least a portion of it, or at least to have a holiday as far as stamp duty is concerned for some time until REITs become popular. So with that, let me once again thank you, Ruini, for moderating this webinar, and the Ceylon Chamber and PwC for organizing this. And let us get on with the rest of the program. Thank you.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Jayaratna. Thank you for that very comprehensive introduction. And I think given the role that real estate plays in the local economy and the increasing and growing role that it's going to play in driving economic growth, the introduction of this framework is very timely and useful. So let me get on now to inviting the next speaker, who will be Mr. Dubit Fernando, Chairman of the Colombo Stock Exchange. And Dubit, let me invite you now to give your opening remarks, maybe focusing more on the investor side and what role REITs will play in capital markets.
Thank you, Ruini. And Thank you to the chamber as well as PwC for organizing this. First of all, apologies, I look a bit casual, but I was in the middle of my short family vacation. But when the chamber invited me to join this, I thought I have to be part of this to promote the REIT product, because it is, as the chairman of the SEC pointed out, the first innovation we really had in our capital markets in a very long time. So for that, I would really like to express our gratitude to the SEC chairman as well as the rest of the SEC, which has moved forward a piece of a capital market improvement that has been in the pipeline for a few years, but the speed at which the SEC has moved this forward is quite commendable. And this will allow us, I think, to start further enhancing what we have to offer in the capital market. So there are really just three points I want to cover, because the SEC chairman has given you plenty of background and context on the REITs framework. So first is how the REITs, introduction of REITs will meet a couple of the objectives of the Colombo Stock Exchange in developing the market. The second is, I will quickly touch on some of the high-level benefits to both property owners as well as investors, and finally walk you through an example of a REIT that launched the REIT market in Hong Kong, which is a very big market for properties. So, from our perspective at the Stock Exchange, we, among our goals, we certainly want to make sure that there is a much more diverse range of products, particularly for retail investors, where people can access products which have not only some upside, but lower risk in terms of a downside protection as well as yield. So, this is certainly in line with what we want to do to enhance the attractiveness of products in the Stock Exchange for retail as well as institutional investors. Secondly, we're very keen to increase the number of large liquid counters that are traded on the exchange, and certainly REITs have the capacity to do that given how large some of the property portfolios are of property developers. And one thing interesting to note is these REITs can be actually created putting together portfolios from various property owners. It doesn't have to be from a single property owner. So it certainly meets our objectives on those two fronts in developing and enhancing the capital market and its attractiveness. Secondly, in terms of benefits to both investors and property owners, clearly, as the SEC chairman mentioned, retail investors in particular, the very attractive property asset class has not been accessible, certainly not yielding assets, often because the initial size of acquiring a property is quite large, as you all know. So through REITs, we are allowing investors of all sizes and forms to invest in the earnings stream and the valuation upside of the property asset class through buying smaller units in the overall projects. So that is a big win for us in terms of diversifying the investable asset classes, where particularly among the retail asset classes, you're generally limited to bank deposits, other fixed income instruments, and the share market. So this offers another product with characteristics that are not entirely correlated to some of the other asset classes. From a property owner's perspective, clearly your ability to offload the property assets, which are non-essential or non-critical from an ownership perspective to your businesses is an essential part of what this does for you. So this will help with cleaning up balance sheets, restructuring.
You're on mute. Can you please unmute?
Okay, sorry, that happened automatically. I was just starting to say, from a property owner's standpoint, clearly it allows you to run a much lighter balance sheet, enhancing your returns on equity. Because if the property you own for various purposes is not essential to your business, you know, you can very easily enter into sale leaseback arrangements. And yes, of course, you can do a sale leaseback arrangement without a REIT structure. But what happens is what we've seen in the market, the ability to acquire assets, large property assets, is very limited given the smaller capital pools. But what a REIT does is it will enhance the number of investors that can come and invest and acquire your property assets. So we are hoping that this will enable much better performance of some of the corporates as well as property developers as well. So the final point is, just to give you a sense of how REITs can perform. Back in 2005, when I was, working in an investment bank in Hong Kong, our investment bank advised the Housing Authority of Hong Kong in creating the first ever REIT in Hong Kong called the Link REIT. Just to give you a snapshot of what happened there, the REIT included a number of retail spaces, parking spaces, and so on that were owned by the Housing Authority. The REIT IPO'd with about $2.5 billion Hong Kong dollars worth of equity being listed. The subscription was, 19% oversubscribed by the institutional tranche, and about 12 times oversubscribed for the retail tranche. It was offering a yield of about 6 or 7%. And if you look at how that has performed until the COVID struck in the market over the 15 years, the REIT itself generated a 15% annualized return, not including dividend payments. So this is the scale of impact that REITs can have on and how attractive this can be as an asset class. And I only speak of that example to show that done properly, done within the right regulatory framework, what we're introducing here is not just another listing on the stock exchange. If we can get two or three high quality property groups to put their assets in through REITs into the market, what you're looking at is a game-changing investment opportunity for the investor base as well. So with that, I wish all of you who are property owners well in trying to figure out how you can access the REITs. There are lots of people here on this call from the SEC, from the CSE, who will be very willing to spend a lot of time to explain what the REIT framework is and how it will basically be rolled out. And all you need to do is ask. And we welcome any and everyone to join the discussion on this topic. And hopefully we will see a couple of good REITs coming out soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Dumit. Thanks for that very encouraging and comprehensive coverage of the impact on investors. And it is most encouraging to know that we have many examples in regional markets, as you mentioned, where this has been a very successful asset class. We'll now get into the details, ladies and gentlemen. May I also kindly remind you, all of you, to keep your mics muted, because we can still hear a little bit of background sounds coming up through the speaker. We now move on to the presentation on the regulatory framework to be done by Dr. Harshana Surya Peruma, Director Corporate Affairs of the Securities and Exchange Commission. So Harshana will actually provide us all the details or most of the details of how the framework is currently structured. Over to you, Harshana. Harshana, I hope you're linked up and you can hear us. Ayanti and Harshana, are you there on the call? Ladies and gentlemen, just give us a few minutes, please, until we connect Harshana and get the presentation up. Yes, Harshana, we can see you now.
Sorry, can you hear me clearly, Rohini?
Yes, Harshana, yes. We just handed over to you. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Harshana Surya Peruma will now take us through the detailed presentation on the framework and the details of the regulatory framework. So we can see you and hear you clearly, Harshana. You can start.
Wonderful. Very good morning to everyone. Screen is being shared. Rohini, can you see the presentation on your screen?
Yes, Harshana. It is coming up. You can put it to the full screen, I think. We can see the entire screen. So if you put it to slideshow, it will be clearer.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's fine, Harshana. Let's continue. I think you can start. We can see your screen. Harshana, you're muted. Yeah, unmute. Yes. We can hear you as well. Yes.
Thank you. Very good morning to you, Rohini. Apologies for those tiny glitches. As the chairman of the SEC and the chairman of the CSC briefly explained the framework, a lot of thought has gone into develop the concept to ensure the stakeholders will benefit, meaning the investors who have already invested in the property sector, the public who want to invest in the real estate related investment products, and managing companies who want to structure the products and get the parties together, etc. So because of this significant potential the regulator has seen, and as particularly we made submissions back in 2016 or prior to that, and the national budget proposal that was approved in the parliament very clearly indicated the need to have listed REITs in the country to meet the demand and the investment potential. Then the particular framework that has been developed provides the ability to convert existing income generating properties into the REIT. So when you say existing income generating properties, those are the three key criteria a property needs to meet in order to enter into the REIT. Item number one is the requirement for it to be completed, fully completed. Second one, it has to be occupied. The criteria of occupancy was brought in particularly to avoid tug of wars between the regulators and the issuers of various types of permits, that the building is not in a position to allow people to move in, so that the occupancy, already in occupancy status, will address that issue. And the next criteria is the income generating aspect of the property. So that will clear some of the initial doubts whether the property is having the potential to generate any income, etc. And the third point of advantage, particularly from a cash flow side of it, both to the existing investor who has invested in the property and new investors who are coming into the REIT. So from the existing investor or the sponsor, as we call it in the REITs, within the REITs framework, it allows him to cash the existing property or the project in which he has already invested. And it will allow him to move on to the next project and so on. So if the property owner wishes to hold on to the property in the balance sheet, then he will have a second asset in the balance sheet if he decides to lease out the first property into the REIT. Alternatively, the asset could be transferred as on outright basis onto the REIT, and the property owner or the existing investor can utilize the cash proceeds to move on with new projects into various areas. Similarly, the investors who are coming into the REITs, this creates a significant cash flow advantage compared to the conventional products that we have in the market currently, where the certainty of receiving dividends is not very clear, because it is of the it is at the discretion of the board of directors of the companies who will decide whether to declare dividends or not, and if to declare, how much to declare dividends or not. Whereas within the REITs concept, the gazetted rules requires 90% of the dividends to be distributed. So that's a significant advantage. The investors know, depending on the timing of distribution of dividends, managing companies proposing, it could be on a monthly basis, it could be on a quarterly basis, biannual, annual, etc., because the property is generating continuous returns. So it will provide the certainty to the investors as well in order to plan their cash flows. And a fourth significant advantage is the 2017 tax pass-through structure that is approved for the unit trusts. We expect the first wording on the REITs framework very clearly identifies the rules may be cited as the Unit Trust Code for Sri Lanka Real Estate Investment Trust number 1 of 2020. I just read the statement from the Gazette. So this indicates REITs is a sub-variant of the existing unit trust, where collective investors' funds pooled and invested, which is similar to that of a unit trust. So the tax pass-through advantage will be, we expect by all means, it will be available to the REITs structure as well. So moving on to the basic structure of a REIT, it has three components. One side of it is on the regulatory structure. The middle section that I have indicated here on how the REIT itself is structured. And the third aspect of it is the asset structure. Let's start from the regulatory structure of it. The SEC has already gazetted the rules relating to the REITs. So the SEC side of it, or the main framework, is now enabled, and it has the force of law as far as the provisions of the gazette is concerned. Then the second aspect of the regulatory structure is the listing rules, because as chairman of the SEC indicated, by definition, the REITs are to be listed. It's a slight different to that of the existing unit structure framework that we have. The SEC allows unlisted unit trusts to be created, whereas in the REIT structure, it is only listed REITs. Why we decided to do so? Because it requires a lot of transparency in this engagement. So the financials will be readily available, the valuation details will be readily available. So the listing rules will detail out what are those requirements, and by listing the REIT, it enables these certain governance elements to be brought in that are available to the existing listed companies, etc. So it will complete some of the areas that investors are looking for from an investment relating to real estate. Then based on the framework that we have created.
Sorry, if you can flip the slides, I think then the audience can see the slides. We currently don't see the slides moving, Harshana.
Sorry, can you see the SL REIT structure slide currently?
No, Harshana, we can only see the cover slide. So just go page down and you should be able to see.
Uh, One second, our IT is assisting me here. One second.
Yeah, we can see the framework now, and I think you are on the structure, right? Yes, next slide.
Can you see the slides now?
Yeah, I can see the Sri Lanka REIT framework slide. So I think the structure is the next one, right?
Yeah, yes.
Can see it now. Yeah, now we can see the REIT structure. That's fine.
Okay. Rohini, just to understand, in case that its slides are not moving, could you kindly let me know? I'll also indicate that I'm moving on to the next slide as well. So if there are no changes, please disturb me and let me know.
Sure, we'll
Thank
do
you.
That.
So I'll quickly run through on the SL REIT structure slide that I'm currently on. The regulatory structure is the one that we briefly discussed, which is on the left-hand side. Can you see it, Rohini?
Yes, Harshana. Yeah, it is on the screen.
I suppose there is a bit of a lag. Then the middle. Wonderful. Thank you. So the regulatory structure, which is on the left hand side, consisting of two components, which is the framework, SEC gazetted framework, and the listing rules, which will be available shortly to the market. And then the REIT structure, which is displayed in the middle of it. The most important party in this equation is the managing company. The managing company is the party who will put the entire proposal together. He will liaise with the existing sponsor or the property owner. The managing company will liaise with the trustee. And with the concurrence of the property owner and the trustee, they will make a proposal to the SEC in order to obtain a license. And it's important to note, this license is not issued to the managing company, but it is issued to the managing company to manage a particular REIT. So that's an important requirement that we need to remember. So if the managing company wants to set up a second REIT, then the managing company is required to make a second application to the SEC, if the managing company wants to increase on the portfolio of the existing REIT, I'm sure obviously there are various options that we will discuss as we go on. And once the trust and the proposal, which is contained in the explanatory memorandum, is approved by the supervision division of the SEC, thank you, Swami, the managing company can then go ahead and form the REIT for the first time. So, based on the license that is received, managing company, the trustee, and the sponsor will get together and create the REIT. And that, based on the details enumerated in the explanatory memorandum, there are separate ways whether the REIT is to be taken into a listing straight away or there's an option. The sponsor and the managing company, based on the strengths of the agreements that they have in place, can decide to transfer the property into the REIT in order to increase the attractiveness of the REIT that is going to be listed in the exchange. So there are different variants that we will go into more detail when we are discussing about them. So once the managing company has obtained the license and the trustee is appointed and the sponsor has agreed for the details in terms of his holding into the REIT on a continuous basis, etc., then the next important aspect is the one on the right-hand section, which is the asset structure. The CSC chairman indicated about some REITs in Hong Kong. If you see some in some of the developed markets, there are greenfield REITs, which are commonly known as development REITs, meaning you can start buying a land, start putting up the building over a period of time, complete that one. And at any point in this process, the REIT can be listed, etc. However, from the Sri Lankan perspective, since it's the first time that we are introducing this product into the market, the SEC thought it is fit to start with completed properties until the market is familiar with the features of the REITs, until investors are familiar with the distribution structure and the exchange is familiar with the details, and the sponsor is familiar with his roles, etc. So everyone is yet to learn some of the aspects relating to Sri Lankan REITs. So because of that, as phase one, we have considered only completed properties which are occupied and income generation aspect. So that does not mean we are completely averse to the development REITs that will come in time to based on the progress that we see on the first phase. And at the bottom of the slide, you can see an important person, which is the property manager. A REIT being essentially, in addition to being a financial product, the property needs to be maintained in a manner.
Could you go full screen mode because we can't see the slides?
This is on full screen on ours. Let's try to switch the computer and see whether it'll help you all. One second. Thank you very much for that feedback.
Just double click on the slide, then it will full screen.
That's fine. Yes, now we can see it clearly.
Right, I have shifted into a different unit. So let's move on. Can you see the slide number 3, which is SL street structure? Rohini?
Yes. Can see, Harshana.
Wonderful, thank you. So at the bottom of this SL street structure is the property manager. He will play an important role as the REIT is functioning and progressing. I'm moving on to the next slide, which is the SL REIT framework. Rubini, can you see the fourth slide, please?
Yes, it is clear, Harshana. Fine.
Thank you very much. So this basically gives the overview of the formal REITs framework. The SEC Act has enabled creation of products of this nature. And under the unit trust code, a new gazette has been issued to enable creation of SL REITs. And the REITs essentially had three components into it within the framework. One is development of the REITs framework, then drafting the gazette. And the gazette also has considered two requirements, which is at the time of granting the license, what are the requirements the REIT manager or the managing company is required to fulfill, and what are the continuous monitoring requirements as far as the supervision division of the SEC is concerned, vis-a-vis the arrangement with the managing company. For example, there are capital requirements on a continuous basis, there are certain director requirements, governance requirements, as far as the managing company is concerned. So those will be discussed in more detail under the continuing monitoring requirements. And the last aspect, which is on the rightmost side, is the listing rules. Once again, listing rules will have two components into it. One is the requirements at the time of listing the REIT. For example, subsequent to obtaining the license from the SEC, the managing company is required to make a listing application within a specified period of time. So it's not a question after obtaining the license, the managing company can stay forever without or take an extended period to apply for a listing. Then the second aspect of listing rules is once CSE has granted the approval to list the REIT, what are the continuous listing requirements, for example, the types of disclosure that is required, financials that need to be brought into the market, the valuer's role, immediate disclosures, so the list goes on. So basically, this captures the framework in a nutshell. Rohini, I'm moving on to the next slide. This is for participants, if someone has not seen the gazette that has been issued, which is currently available in the government website, as government printers website as well as in the SEC website. The 31st July 2020 the gazette issued by the SEC. Now let's move into some of the more detailed aspects onto the features of the REITs. This section, I'm on the next slide now. Can you see that one, Rohini?
Harshana, now you have to switch down to that one.
Thank you. So benefits of REITs we have looked at from two different aspects. One is for the investing public and second one is the managing company. This term public is an interesting one because the proposals that we submitted to the parliament is to ensure the public is able to benefit from the growing real estate sector in the economy. So it is an essential component that we all need to understand. Public who are unable to invest in real estate is now coming into the REIT with the hope and the presumption that they'll be able to benefit from this real estate segment over a period of time. So the terminology public is very important, and all stakeholders have the responsibility. The SEC as the regulator, CSE as the exchange, the managing company as the licensee, the sponsor, because there's a mandatory holding, etc., to ensure the public is benefited out of this initiative as well, because there are certain benefits that is flowing into the REIT that has been created with the blessings of the policymakers as well as from the regulator. So the first item is the increased returns from growing property sector. Then capital appreciation reflected in the REIT's units price. This is an interesting one. When it comes to property that has been transferred on an outright basis, the investors will benefit not only from the regular cash flows, but particularly the capital gains of the property or the property value at the time of disposal. So that's a significant advantage to the property, unit holders over a period of time. And it is an important aspect the REIT manager or the managing company needs to consider as well, because in order to increase the attractiveness when you have multiple properties, at least one of them on outright basis, because then investors are aware in addition to the regular cash flow element, there is a capital gain element as well. Third item, the ability to minimize volatility through 90% rental income distribution, meaning I indicated briefly earlier as well, existing listed companies, the decision whether to distribute dividends or not is vested with the board of directors. And if they decide to distribute dividends, how much to be distributed is also vested with the board of directors. Basically, shareholders not have much of a say in relation to that one. Whereas the gazette itself has mandated 90% distribution of income. There are certain exceptions the gazette is providing. For example, in a particular year, if the managing company is of the view, certain amount of proceeds has to be kept in for a particular reason, then provided the unit holders have granted approval at a general meeting, then you can do so. However, the regulator's expectation is a fundamental requirement to provide this certainty to the investors. Therefore, we expect 90% rental will be distributed, rental income will be distributed. When I say rental income, it does not necessarily limit to the rental income. There will be other income the REIT is generating because of the asset allocation. 80% will be on the real estate side of it, and the balance remaining 20% in other investments. So basically, we are referring to 90% of total income that has to be channeled for distribution. Item number four, from a market perspective, liquidity added to the market through listing, enhanced transparency and governance by being a listed REIT. So there are detailed requirements applicable. I'm sure public will be in a position to know them once the listing rules are approved and published. So there are detailed requirements in order to ensure the transparency, the governance, and the continuity, etc., is maintained over a period of time. So that's also an added advantage. Instead of buying into an unlisted REIT property, so the alternative option for the investors out there is to invest in a property that is not listed. So there's a level of opaqueness, or there are certain details that is not flowing into the investors. Whereas in a listed REIT, now investors will have the peace of mind. There are mandatory requirements in terms of disclosure, in terms of governance, and they have the peace of mind that the SEC as the regulator and CSE as the exchange will step in when the time is required for the regulator and the exchange to step in. And the item number five is mandatory valuation to provide transparency. At the latter part of the presentation, I'm taking you through some real-time examples in other markets, how market prices versus valuers' prices versus the book value is behaving over a period of time. So investors are benefited to benchmark their market prices to the valuers' prices as well, the competent independent valuers' price. So interesting area here, the SEC has set up a panel of valuers. However, it is not required for the managing company to rely on the SEC's panel of valuers, but they can obtain the service of an independent competent valuer that they consider is most appropriate. However, if there is an issue that the SEC needs to get involved, then we will be advised, or the SEC will be advised by the panel of valuers that SEC has created. So we are being blessed with certain individuals by their ex officio capacity, the president of Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, the secretary to the Institute of Chartered, Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, Sri Lanka Institute of Valuers president is a member, the secretary is a member, and a fellow member appointed by the membership is also in the panel created by the SEC. So it's a competent panel that we have, which is, I suppose, the best available within the country in case of a dispute or an issue that we need to reach out to. And benefits for the managing company, it will allow them to diversify their existing income portfolio by adding REITs into their portfolios. If it is an existing unit trust managing company, they can now directly market their REIT into their existing client portfolio. So straight away, multiple benefits. It will reduce their marketing cost, for example. Then item number three, opportunity to increase industry visibility by becoming the first REIT manager. So that's an advantage for the party who is applying for the first time and obtaining the license. And as Chairman indicated at the beginning, there's a lot of interest, more than 10 different parties, Ruvini, I'm happy to share, have already come and discussed with the SEC. And certain parties, they have had second discussion with the SEC as well. So that indicate the level of interest to become the first REIT manager out there. And item number four is capitalize on the shared overhead structures. If an existing company is becoming the managing company, then you don't have to go through and recruit a full gamut of staff to comply with the requirements. Obviously, there are certain expert capacities has to be brought in. However, you can benefit from the shared overhead structure and combined marketing efforts, etc. And another benefit to the managing company is to increase opportunities for additional fee income. The REIT is allowing them to charge various types of fees. There could be entry type of fees such as entry fees, performance fees, benchmark fees. So the details are provided in the Gazette. I'm moving on to the next slide. Ruvini, can you see the managing company slide?
Not yet. Yes, it has come on now.
Wonderful. Okay. Thank you. And managing company, as we indicated earlier, is an essential requirement to obtain a license. And the managing company has to be a body corporate incorporated in Sri Lanka. And there's a stated capital requirement of 50 million plus. 50% or more of that one has to be local equity at all. And the 50 million capital requirement is a continuous requirement. And there was an interesting question once came, if the managing company is setting up a second REIT, whether do they need to demonstrate a second 50 million requirement or a cumulative of 100 million? Answer is no. At any time it's 50 million, the managing company's capital requirement should be. And it shall have entered into an agreement either for an outright purchase or to lease. That is at the time of coming to obtain the license. He needs to demonstrate that there is a party or a sponsor that has already agreed either to transfer the property outright or is willing to give the property as a lease. And he has managing company should have also engaged in discussions with the trustee, it has to be a trustee approved by the SEC. It has to be a commercial bank licensed by the central bank. And we have had discussions with currently registered trustees with the SEC, and they have indicated their willingness to come on board if a party requires to set up a REIT. So that does not restrict the existing number of parties who are already registered. Any other commercial banks who are willing to get into this area is free to apply for a registration with the SEC to become a trustee. I'm moving on to the next slide. We are on the trustee slide. Can you see that one, Rohini?
Yes, Harshana. Yeah.
Thank you.
We can see, the trustee can be seen now.
Wonderful. Thank you. So the trustee appointed with the prior approval of the SEC, meaning the trustee, the commercial bank, has to obtain the registration from the SEC. The supervision division will facilitate that one, subject to meeting the requirements. And it has to be a bank licensed by the central bank, as I indicated earlier. And there are certain key responsibilities the trustee has to ensure. One is he is acting in the fiduciary capacity. Therefore, the fiduciary duty to hold the assets of the REITs in trust for the benefit of the unit holders. Then trustee shall ensure the validity of title deeds or lease agreements, whether the property is having the relevant approvals. It could be fire approvals, certain safety approvals, certain municipal council approvals, town council approvals, validity of contracts entered between the tenants, etc. I'm sure there will be standard agreements that will be validated, and that the property is registered in the name of the trustee. Trustee needs to ensure the valuation obligations are carried out on a timely manner. The legal audit, if appropriate, as far as the property is concerned, to ensure that it has clear title, and to ensure the investments and borrowing limits of the REIT is maintained by the managing company. We can go into detail for the borrowing limits, etc. Then I'm moving on to the next slide. I am on the slide titled Permitted Investments. Can you see that one, Rubini, please?
Yes, we can see it now.
Thank you. The SL REIT shall only invest in the following, the gazette says, up to maximum of 80% of the value of the fund shall be invested in fully completed, fully or partially occupied. The percentage, if it is partially, is 20%, and it should be generating income. When you say generating income, there should be audited financials available to demonstrate that at least for a period of 12 months, the property was generating income. And the remaining 20% could be invested in government securities and or cash equivalent, near cash. However, if the managing companies of the view, depending on the type of the property that they have invested in, there's no need to hold on to 20% cash, they can make a request to the SEC to allow them to exceed this 80% limit, let's say, for example, 90%, and to hold on to 10% in cash or near cash. So SEC will consider the circumstances that the managing company is demonstrating, and based on that, a decision will be made to grant approval. Moving on to the next slide, the REIT's property. Can you see that slide, Rohini, please?
Yes, yeah, it is visible.
Thank you. It is important to note it should be a newly created REIT. We have seen a party has already established an entity as well. We are very happy to see the level of enthusiasm the stakeholders are demonstrating. So for the purpose of REIT, however, it has to be a newly created REIT. If an existing REIT, if someone has created, which is not within the framework as required to be compliant with the gazette, then that will not be considered. The newly created REIT should purchase the property from the sponsor with the intention of leasing. So in other words, with the intention of selling or immediately disposing will not be considered. because the idea is once again to hold on to the property for a period of time, generate income, distribute income, and once the capital appreciation there over a period of time, it could be considered for disposal. There are specific requirements that we can go through when it comes to disposal of property. Then it could be either a leasing of a property from the sponsor with the intention of subleasing, either commercial property or residential property. And it's interesting, as Chairman indicated, when I say property, the infrastructure projects are also considered. The gazette is specifically authorizing infrastructure projects that are completed and generating revenue to be considered for a REIT. And it needs to be a fully completed property with a minimum occupancy. When I say fully completed, if the REIT manager is, for example, proposing in his explanatory memorandum, in order to enhance the value of the property, a minor modification is required, then up to a 20% of the value of the building can be considered as not completed. When I say not completed, that is from a perception of facelifting of the property, not necessarily that something has to be completed in order to obtain a COC, etc. For a facelifting or certain modification which will not require unless it is not completed, the particular license is not obtained type of scenarios will not be considered. However, to enhance the appealing of the level of the property, if there is a facelifting or a modification is required or proposed, that can be considered. Then any other property upon obtaining the approval of the SEC and subject to any conditions, that's a broader one. That's where I said the in addition to real estate, infrastructure projects can also be considered. Income generating infrastructure is the example that I have given. I'm moving on to the next slide, which is the valuations. Rubini, can you see the slides, valuations, please?
Yes, Archana, it's visible. And also, we may have another 2 to 3 minutes.
Sure. I think we are reaching the end very soon. Thank you. Then appointment of a valuer is very important, and there should be 2 valuations within a given year. And the qualifications, it has to be a fellow member of Institute of Valuer or Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, or it could be the government chief valuer if it is a government property. The valuation report should be shared with the trustee, managing company, the exchange, and the SEC. And I indicated earlier about the fees. It could be annual fees, benchmark performance fees, and performance fees that the managing company could charge into the REIT as expenses. Moving on to the next slide on pricing. Can you see the slide on pricing, please? Yes. Rubini, thank you. Pricing is a straightforward one because since they are listed REITs, the market will determine the price subsequent to listing. But at the time of listing, expert input is required. Managing company is required to obtain input of an expert party in order to determine the listing price. The dealing of units is via the market. Suspension of dealing of units could occur depending on situations that are detailed out in the gazette or in the listing rules. The creation and cancellation of units subsequent to listing is allowed. For example, similar to right issues, once the REIT is floated, if they want to acquire a second property, they can raise additional funding by issuing additional units. I'm moving on to the next slide, which is the listing of REITs. Can you see the slide, please, Rubini?
Yes.
So it has to be listed within 3 months of obtaining the license. It could be go into a IPO, or even it could be a introduction as far as listing methodology is concerned. There is a minimum of 100 unit holders at the time of listing. And in order to be eligible to claim any applicable tax benefits, the REIT should at all times maintain 50 unit holders. This is in order to provide abusing of the benefits that are already provided and yet to be provided into the REITs. And the sponsor will be locked in for a continuous period of time. However, at the same time, the sponsor can exit at any time after the first 6 months, provided the sponsor is bringing in a strategic investor to replace him. So even though on the default side of it is locked in, at any time strategic investor can exit by bringing a replacement. The replacement party can be one party or it can be multiple parties. Then there should be a 20% public float at the time of listing. Listing rules will tell about the continuous requirement, and it needs to comply with the listing rules on an ongoing basis. And as I indicated earlier, exit via market only. So liquidation pressure will not come into the managing company. The market will provide the facility for the investors to exit. This is where some of the recent slides, recent pricing that I have checked, the way how the prices are moving. This is a listed REITs in BSE in India. It indicates the way how price have moved from 2016 up to 2020, and if you all can notice, the COVID impact is reflected as well, but indices are holding on to the prices very clearly. So this shows the resilience of the REITs as an investment instrument into the wider market impacts. This is an example from India. Then this is another example from National Exchange. Once again, similar pattern is demonstrated. COVID impact is seen at the latter part of it. However, it shows its resilience. Then let's move into a Malaysian REIT. These are very recent slides that I've taken from them. You can see the sustainability of return over a period of time. However, COVID impact is felt by the REIT prices as well, but it's picking up, we can see very clearly. And the trading volumes are also considered. If you look at, if you can see the trading volumes, which is shown at the bottom of the slide, during the COVID times, even though prices are low, very high volume. So it is very beneficial to the markets and investors, you can see, because markets, the exchange is providing the opportunity to exit at any time. And this is an example from a Singaporean REIT, very steady growth of the prices over a period of time. However, the COVID impact is felt drastically in Singapore, but immediately thereafter it has recouped some of the losses and moving forward. And this is a comparison of various price options available of particular REITs. I have taken three examples, one from Malaysia, one from Singapore, and one from India. I have converted the prices to US dollar equivalent in order to compare for comparison purposes. Always we have seen the valuer's price has been slightly above the NAV of the REIT or the book value. However, market price has been either, it's a mixed bag, either it could be lower compared to the NAV or it could be higher compared to the NAV. So even in Sri Lanka, these three options or benchmarks will be available for investors to determine the price or the bid or the acquisition or buy bids or sell bids. The NAV are available, last traded prices are available, and the valuer's price for the property is also available. So I suppose this brings to the end of my presentation, Rohini. We'll be happy to take many questions as we go. Thank you very much once again. Over to you, Rohini.
Thank you, Harshana. Thank you for a very comprehensive coverage of all the key provisions of the regulations. I think it's very clear. And there are many questions now popping up on the screen. So may I ask the panel members, Rajiv Bandaranaike, CEO of the Colombo Stock Exchange, Ayanthi Abhevikrama, Director Legal and Enforcement of SEC, and Mr. Ravi Abhesurya, Co-Chair of the National Agenda Committee at the Chamber, to please join us on screen for the panel discussion. And Harshana, please remain on for the panel discussion as well. Right, if we can switch off the slides, that's fine. Yes, we can see you, Ravi. Right. So maybe if I start off with, because there are many questions from the audience as well, start off with some questions to Rajiv on the next most important thing that's going to come up in this area, which is the listing rules. What will the listing rules actually, what form would it take? and also how similar would a REIT be to a regular listed company? Will sort of the expectations of the exchange when a REIT comes and lists, will it be similar to a normal listed company, which we are all now familiar with? What are the similarities, differences? And also many people were interested in knowing how does an investor actually now participate. So when a promoter brings a REIT and a REIT manager comes into the market, how does the process take place? How do the subscriptions happen? How do investors trade and how do they get out? Rajiv, can I hand over this question to you?
Yeah, sure, Vani. Good afternoon. And once again, thanks for putting this very useful forum together to talk about REITs and promote REITs. Quite a bit of interest, as Harshana mentioned. In the interest of time, Rohini, I may not be able to go into all the details, but let me quickly talk about some of the requirements for a REIT to list over and above what Harshan indicated. To be eligible for a listing of units of a REIT, you need to first be managed by a managing company licensed by the SEC in terms of the SEC rules on REITs, which are gazetted and which Harshan referred to. Secondly, an application for a listing has to be submitted to the exchange within 1 month of obtaining that approval from the SEC. Then the third point is that the listing should be for all of the units issued pursuant to a REIT of which the listing is sought. So you need to have all of it, all the units listed. And therefore, the units has to be fully paid, free from any lien, and freely transferred. So quite similar to shares. Then there's also a listing requirement that the value of the real estate assets owned by the REIT at the time of listing shall not be less than 500 million rupees. So that's a minimum value. Then I think Harshan did allude to the public holding requirement that 20% of the units issued by the REIT shall be held by a minimum of 100 public unit holders at the date of listing. So there is an element of a public holding requirement that has been brought in. Then I think this point was also mentioned by Harshana that the sponsor or the strategic investor must hold a minimum of 30% of the total units, and there is a lock-in period of 6 months from the date of listing of the units of the Sri Lanka REIT, and the lock-in period applicable thereafter has to be in accordance with the SEC rules on REITs. Then again, the trust deed, we refer to a trust deed, has to include the provisions set out in Section 6 of the listing rules of the exchange, which is similar to the unit trusts that are currently there. Then also there's a requirement to have a registrar to attend to the registration process. Apart from that, I think the salient features are quite well covered by Harshana in his presentation, but let me just very briefly touch on some other points here. As you know, the rules of the exchange has now with the XCC for approval, and we expect the rules to be approved in a couple of weeks, and then they'll be published on our website, so you can take a sort of deeper look into it. There is also the requirement that subject to the provisions of the Unit Trust Code, appointment of a trustee again has to be approved by the SEC, and both the sponsor and the property manager are bound by the SEC rules on REITs. As we know, there are four parties to the REIT: the managing company, the trustee, the property management company, and the sponsor or the main promoter. So all of those parties, the rules cover obligations of all these parties. The requirement for the public holding requirement be covered. And once the SEC approval is granted, then the managing company could carry out initial public offer by subscription, or they could also come in by way of an introduction. And in terms of the application process, is very similar to the share listing applications. the both the stock exchange and CSE will simultaneously peruse the explanatory memorandum that is submitted and all of the related documents so as to expedite the process of the approvals. And again, approval of the units will be in terms of all of the listing rules that have been set out. One quick comment, Rumini, if I can, on the corporate governance requirements as well, quite similar to what we have now in terms of, for example, independent directors, that there's a requirement for the managing company to have two independent directors and or those independent directors to be equivalent to 1/3 of the total number of directors. And there's a requirement also that the independent directors have to meet the criteria of independence as set out in the SEC rules on REITs. And there's also a section on the composition of committees, and there's a requirement for an investment committee exam, for example. And those are all have to be in accordance with the SEC rules that have been published on REITs. So in very briefly, Rumini, these are some of the rules that are going to come in. So there are no surprises from the CSC rules. It's very much in tandem to the set of detailed set of rules that have been issued by or gazetted by the SEC.
Thank you, Rajiv. So I think there are a few questions here. I can see on the role of the sponsors and the 30% holding requirement. If you could just perhaps elaborate on the reason for having that 30% requirement and how it would ensure that the management of the REIT is enhanced and the accountability for it.
I think in order for the sponsor and the lead to have some form of stake in the REIT, I think that is why the 30% was thought of, and I think we have benchmarked some of the other practices in other markets as well. So this all these rules, Rubini, have been based on fairly extensive research that we have done in the region and in other markets as well, and we are quite, I think, in tandem with some of these tried and tested markets. Harshana really mentioned some of these markets, and if we have time, we can go into some of the markets and what they have done. So I think this 30% is necessary for that level of commitment as well on the part of the promoter.
Thank you, Rajiv. We'll now move on to a few questions that we saw being posed, and we had received a few questions as well in advance on the kind of returns that investors can expect. Now, when we look at REITs and the real estate asset class, it is somewhere in between, I would say. We have fixed income instruments like debentures, which give a fixed rate of interest, either biannually or quarterly as a return. And also, we have equity, which is very volatile, and very the value of equity depends on markets and business conditions. Ravi, if I may pose this question to you, when you look at real estate, and a rentable property, there is a fairly steady stream of income, but there is also economic risk and risk of rentals going up and down, and sometimes occupancy can be variable. So how do you see the risk levels to the investor of a REIT, and in that context, what sort of returns do you think investors will be factoring in? Ravi? Ravi, you're on mute, and you also need to switch on the camera. Ravi, if you can please unmute, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now? Can you see me?
Yes, we can hear you, Ravi, but yes, we can see you as well, yes. So in terms of returns to investors, Ravi, what would be the expectation?
Yeah, from a return to investors perspective, if you look at the real estate market in Sri Lanka, we can get a pretty good idea pre-COVID. Post-COVID, unfortunately, things are yet to be clear. If you look at now the rental yields, we have had about 5 to 9% return on rental yields on condominiums with the top grade commercial property generating definitely 5 to 8% per annum. And also that is the commercial property, whereas condominiums 5 to 9. So, and on top of that, you have the capital appreciation, which would have been on the average about 7%. So if you take both together, we have a noteworthy return of 13 to 17% on an annual basis, which I would say is the highest return you can expect from any asset class in Sri Lanka. So this is all pre-COVID. So let me very briefly tell you the returns of other asset classes. If you look at the land price index, which is a kind of proxy for hotels over the last 10.5 year period, went about 11.3%, whereas fixed deposits about 10%, and inflation about 4.8. So other asset classes have been below that. Now, if you take savings accounts, it has generated about 4.6, gold about 2.2, and the ASPI, unfortunately, it's a negative 2.6. This is taking a 10.5 year period up to June 30th, 2020. So, which clearly shows REITs is a great diversifier for any portfolio. And in a portfolio, you know, if you have about 5 to 20% in real estate, you can have a great benefit because of the correlation with other asset classes, which I mentioned, are much lower in a REIT portfolio. So it's an asset that gives constant, or I would say more definite returns. If you take even as previously mentioned, in the US market, if you take last 15-year period, REITs have given the highest return out of 8 periods in the 15-year period. So 8 years they are given the highest. So implying that it is a consistent and higher return provider compared to stocks. And unfortunately, COVID-19 have had an impact on the REITs recently, but I can explain that a little bit later. But if you take the impact in the US market, in the first half of 2020, REITs have had a 13.3 negative return. I will explain later, of course, on the impact that could have on the Sri Lanka market, because all the returns I mentioned is pre-COVID.
Thank you, Ravi. If I can move on to a few questions to Ayanti on the valuation side. Ayanti, will the valuers actually be accredited by SPC? Because now the valuation of the REIT will play obviously a key role in determining to an extent the returns to investors. So will these valuers be licensed by SPC, and how do you ensure the credibility of the valuers who are participating? Will you have valuation guidelines for them? Can you tell us a little bit on the valuation?
Yes, Ruini, thank you. You can hear me. Good morning to everybody. Yes, actually at the moment, the SEC does not have a regulatory reach directly to a valuer. But however, as Harshana said in his presentation, we will have an approved set of panel of valuers, and a valuer will be selected by the trustee initially. And he is expected to comply with all the accepted valuation standards which are relating to the subject matter. And the SEC, in the event of any doubt or any kind of discrepancy on the face of the valuation, the SEC will have a panel of valuers, which the SEC will have recourse to in order to check a valuation or the reasonability of a valuation. So that is how we have structured. And in fact, the SEC will be issuing a directive vis-a-vis the any kind of guidelines which the valuers will be expected to follow. And that is yet to be done. So that's how we will go about it.
fantastic. Also on the REIT holders, unit holders, their right and what can they expect? Then they don't feel that there is, you know, irregularity or some kind of mismanagement, what sort of recourse will they have?
Yes, actually the entire gamut of the REIT rules have been structured in such a way in order to protect the rights of unit holders. As you know, it has been structured within a unit trust. So you have the managing company, and there are requirements for the managing company to have minimum the corporate governance requirements in respect of independent directors. And the entire duties of the managing company, if you look at the rules, it has been structured in a way that will safeguard the interests of unit holders. Now, the managing company is required to have a property manager, a compliance officer, designated people to go into the investment management functions, as well as an investment committee. So if you look at the structure, unlike any other unit trust at the moment, which is existing in Sri Lanka, this particular structure has taken into consideration the fact that the underlying assets are going to be real estate. And the investment committees that have been appointed have all given its due focus and attention to the fact that the managing company, the trustee, and the investment committees, and the main employees like project managers and so on and so forth will be people who will be having very good experience with regard to managing real estate investment trusts. And the trustee will be the first supervising authority of the managing company that will ensure that the managing company will manage the REIT in keeping with these rules, the SEC Act, and any directives that will be issued by the SEC. And you will also notice the fact that the investment committee will also have an attorney at law on the committee, and also an engineer. And the trustee will be expected to take prompt action in the event of any irregularities. The compliance auditor has to report to the board of directors of the managing company, and if they don't rectify any kind of irregularity, they will have to report that to the trustee and keep the SEC informed simultaneously. And the compliance officer in a managing company will have to play a major active role. And so will be the trustee, because these are not passive roles anymore. And because of the issues that will be specific to real estate, special focus will be given to expertise in that area. And the regulatory framework takes into consideration all those factors, especially with real estate in mind, and to prevent and minimize any kind of fraud happening or any kind of irregularities that can take place vis-a-vis real estate. So that would be the major focus. And if you look at the entire gamut of the rules, it is the managing company, the duties of the managing company is not only applicable to the board of directors, but to all the employees of the managing company as well. And the main duty is to act in the best interests of the unit holders. They must have uberima fides, basically utmost good faith in everything they do, and transparency. So that has been built into the rules. So, I would say where the unit, so that would be the major thrust on the protection of unit holders. And even in the requirement to ensure that the sponsor does not exit after merely selling the property into a REIT or merely leasing his property, he will be there because he will hold a minimum of 30% of the issued units. So there is a purpose behind every protection, every structure or the rule that has been brought in is actually to protect the unit holders.
Thank you, Auntie. Actually, that's very useful because I can see a few more follow-up questions on that. Now, as for the regulation, we can see a very clear demarcation between the manager, the sponsor, and then how these parties operate. Yes. So for example, the sponsor holds 30% and the management company cannot be in any way connected to the sponsor, right? So
that's right. Yes.
Different people. then further we see a provision where you can't, if you're leasing your own property back, if there's a sale and lease back arrangement, it has to be backed by a bank guarantee.
That's right.
Now, yeah, there were questions on, you know, now when you look at a commercial arrangement, sometimes these sort of linkages may be more advantageous because you're running a real estate business, right? And say you sell your property to a REIT and you have a guaranteed lease back for 25 years. It may be a good safeguard for the unit holders or REIT holders as well. And also in managing a property, the property manager and the sponsor, actually, if they are the same party, they will be more efficient. So there were points of view coming up like that. What is the reason for this segregation and for having these demarcations? Maybe if you and Harshana both can add some points and clarity to that.
Yes, I think the main reason for the demarcation is to mitigate conflicts of interest. And if you will know throughout the rules, where the unit holder's interests will become paramount. When there's a conflict between the interests of the managing company, the business interest, and that of the real estate trust, the latter has to prevail all at every point. So there is a clear segregation of the roles, and in fact, even the demarcation of the assets of the trust. It is independent of the managing company and also of the trustee. So there has been a clear independence created and a demarcation of the roles created in order to mitigate any kind of conflicts of interest.
Ruini, I'll take an example to demonstrate. Let's see if there is this segregation is not in place and a building is available, the managing company and the sponsor is also have some thin lines or gray lines, and it could be one and same, let's say for the moment, and that sponsor has now, or the managing company has now rented out part of that building. Let's see, in the event of a default, now the managing company or the sponsor who has rented out the place is supposed to sue himself to recover the outstanding dues. So that doesn't kind of add up. So that's why, so that's a worst case example that we have taken. But just to avoid very uncomfortable situations of that nature, the managing company is suing the managing company itself to recover the outstandings. That is why these regulations are brought in. If a related party, either sponsor or the managing company, is renting out property from the REIT, then it has to be backed by a bank guarantee. So then this uncomfortable situation does not arise to go behind to get into litigation to recover. You basically hold on to the bank guarantee and call for the rent. So that's kind of a practical aspect as to why we brought in this demarcations to segregate the respective roles. And we also need to understand the public is going to invest in this property. So how are we going to create that element of trust among people, particularly knowing the Sri Lankan context, that there will be arm's length transactions will take place. So that's why in the first place, we have tried to limit the engagement, but we have not restricted. If you want to still rent out your own property, yes, we have allowed for that one, subject to having a bank guarantee to comfort the public investors who are coming into the picture. So these are added responsibility while you getting into a publicly traded instruments in the market. I'm sure everyone would understand that one. Thank you.
And the bank guarantee is only for basically.
Yes, that's right.
The bank guarantee is also only up to the tenure of the REIT. So it's not a kind of a indefinite kind of a responsibility.
That's right.
Yes.
Yes, Ruini.
Thank you for that clarification, because I think when you purely look at it as a business, people saw advantages in the synergy of, you know, being these parties being together. But we understand that, you know, your clarification was useful to understand why the segregation is required. Also, I can see many questions coming up on the tax impacts. So Harshana earlier explained that it basically the REIT structure similar to a unit trust will be having pass-through status. However, there were questions on whether value added tax, capital gains tax when properties are disposed of, and a whole lot of other taxes applicable to a business situation, because a REIT is actually a live functioning business. So in a normal business, we pay all these taxes, right? Value added tax. And if we sell something, there's income tax, there's capital gains tax. How does it all work? Once again, Harshana, if you could clarify in the situation of a REIT.
Sure. So first of all, we need to be clear, SEC as the capital market regulator is not the deciding party as to what taxes will be applicable and what taxes will not be applicable. However, in general, I can shed some light into the question. Our intention is, or rather regulator's intention is, to ensure there is adequate incentive for people to consider listed REITs as an investment option. That is to propel the growth of the country, which allows property owners to transfer the property into the REIT, cash it, and move on with other developments. It allows new investors to acquire existing property through the REIT, etc. So adequate incentives are being provided over a period of time. That is the expectation. However, there will be particular taxes that will be the currently available taxes, or taxes that may be come in the future. Let's, as the chairman indicated earlier, 4% stamp duty is an applicable tax at the moment. But if you look at the 2016 budget proposal that was tabled, publicly available, it clearly says 4% stamp duty to be exempted for a listed REIT. However, we know in Sri Lanka, the stamp duty is administered through the provincial council structure, and the provincial councils are not in existence even as of now. And the future is yet to be decided also. So but the thinking of the policymaker and the regulators are very clear, because the what is tabled in the parliament indicates 4% stamp duty waiver has to be provided. And as the chairman indicated, if not for the full amount, at least partially, or the deferment of payment of the stamp duty, for example. So the SEC will continue to engage with the policymakers for these matters. And let's look at another tax aspect, the value-added tax elements. So the REIT will be continuously generating income as a business. So then there will be components of value-added tax that will be applicable as well. So once again, SEC is not the deciding party on these tax matters. However, the general rules will be applicable for the moment unless certain clarity is available in the future. And even if you look at it from a, you have to look at it from different angles. If the existing property is held by a company, that is to who's going to be the sponsor, and such properties to be transferred into the REIT, at the time of transferring the property into the REIT, depending on the manner in which how it is held in the balance sheet, there'll be, instead of capital gains tax, there can be income tax onto the transfer of the property on the gain. So I'm sure tax consultants of the respective sponsors need to come and assist them. There can be capital gains tax at the time of transferring the property, depending on the manner in which it was held. And same will be applicable to the REIT as well, subsequent to holding onto the property for a longer period at the point of disposal. If you consider today's structure, there will be elements of capital gains tax as well. So similarly, there will be a array of taxes that is applicable currently. And our intention is we will continue to partner with the chambers, investors, the exchange, the sponsors, to lobby to the respective parties, policymakers, to provide adequate further incentives if required to make the product more attractive. But as a starting point, I'm sure Ravi convinced all of us on the session today, these real estate REITs are generating above average returns. And mind you, in Sri Lanka, the tax pass-through structure is available. So it is directly transferred to the investor, and it will be taxed in the hands of the investor. So now we have to look at holistically, considering all these factors in the equation, to answer a specific question on taxation. Thank you, Rini.
Thank you, Harshana. I'll get back to Rajiva and Ravi for two final comments, because I think now we are sort of we have exceeded time. Ravi and Rajiva, if you could also comment a little bit on the maturity of REITs as a product. Now, when we look at our regional markets, I mean, most of them are emerging markets and growing markets. So they all have very vibrant real estate sectors. And REITs have been in operation in many countries. And investors, as Dumit mentioned earlier in the day, and you all mentioned, and Harshana showed us the chart, investors have also benefited. So how has this product matured over the years? And maybe some countries may have now progressed on to development REITs as well. Can you tell us a little bit about the evolution of these products in different markets and how investors have been responding? Maybe Rajiv, if you could speak first, and then Ravi.
Sure. So Ravini, if I very quickly get on to a couple of markets, let's say Singapore, for example. Singapore is one of the more successful markets where they have introduced REITs. There are, I think, about 43 REITs currently. And last year, the property trust contributed to about 24% of the day-to-day turnover of the Singapore stock market. And they have given a combined market value of about 12% of Singapore's market capitalization as at end of last year. And I think if you talk about market size, it's about $100 billion US dollars. Again, if you look at London, I think there are about 50 REITs with a market cap of over 70 billion that is listed on the London Stock Exchange. I think most popular of them are the office REITs. So if you look at markets as a whole, this evolved in probably early 1960s in the US, but then it evolved to Asia as well. I think in the year 2000, where Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, Malaysia, etc. introduced it, and now last recently Pakistan, South Africa, Thailand, etc. Also have implemented it. I think countries like Sri Lanka, India have got into it right now. So I think REITs are now here to stay, quite widespread as well. And I would think giving, as quite rightly Ravi said, giving good returns. So if you look at any of these markets, Singapore, they have about 42 REITs, Malaysia has 18, Australia has 84, Hong Kong has 12, Japan has 61. So numbers are quite, Thailand has 58. So it seems to have caught on quite significantly. And even in terms of market cap, if you analyze, Japan, it's about 79 billion US, Hong Kong, 23 billion US, Singapore, 48 billion US. So sizes are also quite substantial. And if you look at NYSE, for example, if you look at the REITs equity market cap, it's about 1 trillion, just over 1 trillion. And as a percentage, it's over about 5% of the total equity market cap of 21 trillion. So, and I think their returns in the US is, given their rates, I think over 10%. So that's the kind of impact REITs are having globally.
Yeah, if I also come in, I think Rajiv covered most of the markets. If you take the total, I think there are 37 markets where REITs are operational. And the total market cap is approximately US dollars 3 trillion. So it's a huge market. And out of that, two trillion is listed. So it really helps capital markets as well to get a deeper and broader markets. But the maturity is yet not there in most of the markets. So the key issues in the REIT market is the tax pass-through registration. Certain markets, the governments have not yet completely made it a tax pass-through. See, the real success happens when it is a tax pass-through, and the tax happens in the hands of the ultimate beneficiary. rather than in between. So there is that legislation that has to come, as Harshan explained. Hopefully it will be made properly done in Sri Lanka. Then the next is robust governance structures, which is also very, very important. Again, I think it was very clearly explained by SCC to prevent related party involvement, to minimize the risk of exploitation by insiders. See, this whole thing is very much involved where insiders are doing these structuring it and coming to with approval. So a strong regulator is fundamental to ensure that the trust and confidence of the REIT investors and the ultimate unit holders are well looked after. So I think that is a very important part, and I have strong belief that SEC has all the know-how to do it, because you know, we have had no unit trust getting into any difficulties in Sri Lanka since inception. So it's very much similar in terms of the structures, and we have good trustees who are well entrenched in the trustee function. So both these two are proven concepts. So I think REITs will do very well as a result.
In terms of investors, Ravi, what sort of investors would like REITs? I mean, what's the profile of a typical investor or group of investors who'd come into a REIT?
I think the main investor would be the institutional investors, because for them, you know, like long-term investors like pension funds, insurance funds, it is an ideal investment vehicle because this is long-term. So it's a very good match, and matching in terms of the tenor, and also it's a very good inflation hedge, because always real estate rental yields as well as the ultimate prices are very much related to inflation. So if inflation goes up, real estate rental as well as property values goes up, and also the diversification I mentioned previously also, there's a huge benefit because of the correlation. So when other asset classes go down, this asset class does very well. So in a portfolio, what institutional investors really look for is whether they could minimize the risk and also have a higher return. So both these two objectives will be kind of achieved by investing in REITs because of the qualities it has of a fixed income element in terms of the rental yields, and the equity part is the growth of the capital gains that you can expect in the longer term. So with the low correlation and the connection between other markets, you know, this is a good asset class. Of course, you need to bear in mind that not like fixed deposits, the principal value can go up and down. That is what our retail investors don't understand. They have to take some risk and take a longer term perspective. So there are cycles in the real estate markets also, where due to market changes, there could be some volatility. And classic example is the COVID-19 impact, which will be there for maybe maximum of 1 year, and it will go away. But yes, now,
yeah, sorry, I missed the last bit.
Yes, Ravi, thank you.
The actual cash?
Sorry, Dinok, if you could.
Well, the ink, 120 million.
Can the parts? Yes, thank you. Ravi, thank you very much. I think we've already run 20 minutes over time, and it has been a most interesting discussion. I tried to cover most of the questions that were posed, but I think there were still a few that went unanswered. We will also, as requested, share the recordings and, if possible, the material as well. So the Ceylon Chamber will get back to you with that. On behalf of the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce and PwC Sri Lanka, We'd like to thank both the chairman of the Securities and Exchange Commission and the Colombo Stock Exchange for being with us today. And a very, very hearty thanks to all four of our panel members who provided some very interesting and informative comments. I'm sure there'll be many discussions on this subject going forward as the investors and the developers, the real players in the market are, begin to get their their initiatives together to structure and create REITs. I'm sure there'll be a lot of discussion on the topic going forward. So look forward to hearing many views in the weeks to come. And thank you to all of you, the participants, for being with us for quite some time today.
Rohini, just for a very quick one, may I kindly mention, if there's any participant who requires more clarity on the matters, or investors, or who's willing to be managing companies, etc., see Colombo Stock Exchange and the SEC is there to assist and facilitate. So please feel free to reach out to us. We are there to help. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Harshana. Thank you. That is very encouraging. So, ladies and gentlemen, please do feel free to reach out to the team at SEC and the Colombo Stock Exchange and the Ceylon Chamber of Commerce as well for whatever discussions and clarifications you need. You're most welcome. So, thank you, everyone, and have a good day.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.